like you, mobile platforms. Now in this, first, what is the vulnerable areas in mobile business environment? As we can see in this image, this is the whole environment for our mobile businesses. Like we have mobile devices, Bluetooth enabled devices. We have mobile devices which is also having wireless networks. So these devices connected to the wireless AP. Through that, it can also connect to the wireless service providers. This is a mobile network service provider. Then we have a wireless AP. Then we connect these mobile devices to internet. We connect these devices to internet through wireless network, through mobile network. So these are the vulnerable areas. Like we have app store where we can get the different apps. So mobile app store where we can get the mobile applications. Then we can connect the mobile through the websites, internet. And also mobile networks, mobile devices nowadays used to connect the corporate network also. Now what are the vulnerable areas here? As we can see here, mobile devices itself are vulnerable devices. Itself they are connected. Like if it is Bluetooth enabled devices, so Bluetooth is vulnerable. Mobile devices are vulnerable because of this. Then we have vulnerability in the telephone services. Then we have vulnerabilities in the wireless network. Then also we have vulnerability from the app store. Also the internet is the whole vulnerable area where we can get malicious websites. We can get the sites which can install the backdoors, trojans and all that. So these things are vulnerable here, and these are the vulnerable areas if we see about the business mobile network environment. Now, according to the OWASP mobile top 10 risks, these are the top 10 risks. Now, this is OWASP is an open web application security project. It is an organization project, we can say community project, which is about these things. Now, we can use these according to this project. We have these top 10 risks for the mobile network or mobile devices. So one, first, weak server side control. So server side control, if it is weak, then it is vulnerable. It is the risky thing for mobile devices. Then insecure data storage. If the data storage is not secure, that is also a problem. Insufficient transport layer protection, that is no encryption, that means a problem. Then unintended data leakage. It is also a problem for the database servers, from the database servers. Then poor authorization and authentication, that is also a problem. Then broken cryptography, client-side injection, security decision via untrusted inputs, improper session handling, and lack of binary protection. These are the top 10 risks of mobile we have, according to OWASP. Now, anatomy of a mobile attack. First, point one, the device, attack on the device. So what kind of attack we have on the device? Through the browser, we have phishing attack, framing attack, clickjacking attack, man in the mobile, buffer overflow, data caching attack is there. Then through the phone and SMS, baseband attacks and SMSing. So we can have these attacks as SMSing, then we have smashing, or then we have apps. Through the apps, we have different attacks like sensitive data storage, no encryption, weak encryption, improper SSL validation, config manipulation, dynamic runtime injection, unintended permissions, escalate privileges, access to device and user info. That is what the threats comes from the mobile apps. And that are also malware. Malwares are also available for the mobile devices. Then when it comes to the network part, so in the network part we have the problem for the Wi-Fi, that is no encryption or weak encryption. Raw access point is the problem, that our mobile connect to the raw or fake access point. Then packet sniffing can be the problem, that attacker can sniff the packet through our mobile network. Then man in the middle attack can be done, session hijacking, DNS poisoning, SSL strip, and also fake SSL strip certificate, fake SSL certificate to do the man in the middle attack and sniff the secure connection. These are all attacks related to the network. Now these are the same attack. It can be also done on the normal desktop machine or laptop machine. It can also work for these mobile machines. Then for the data center for the first the web server. So for the internet site, web server, platform vulnerabilities, maybe the platform is not secure, it is vulnerable, it is having the vulnerability, servers misconfigurations, cross-site scripting attacks, then cross-site request forgery attack, weak input validation, and brute force attacks. These are all web server attacks, and these are the normal web servers attack which can also affect the mobile devices. Then also the database attack, that is SQL injection, privilege escalation, data dumping, OS command execution. These are the normal database attacks, and these can also work for the mobile devices. Now how a hacker can profit from mobile when successfully compromised? Now if the hacker is able to compromise the mobile device, then what the hacker will get? First, it will get the surveillance, that means it can record the audio, record the camera, call logs, it can see the location in SMS messages. Then botnet activities, it can use the mobile to launch the DDoS attack, denial of service attack. It can use the mobile to do the click fraud, sending premium rate SMS messages also. And by sending this premium rate SMS messages, it can affect the financial things. So financial problems are there for sending the premium rate SMS messages. It is harming our financial things. Then stealing the transaction authentication numbers, that is what we get when we do the online transactions. Then extortion via ransomware, it can use our number or our mobile device to do the ransom or these extortion calls or messages. Then fake antivirus, making expensive calls also. That is all financial problems. Then for the data theft, account details can be compromised. It can get the account details, contact details, call logs, phone numbers, and also it can steal the data via app vulnerabilities, stealing international mobile equipment identity number, that is IMEI number. Then also the attacker can use our mobile and do the impersonation to send the SMS redirection, sending the email messages, posting to the social media, and in the name of the victim. So what it will get, according to 16 million mobile devices infected worldwide, we can say 6 out of the top 20 mobile threats are spy phone apps that will spy on your phone. 14% of homes are infected with malwares. Now what are the mobile attack vector? So these are the different type of attacks we have for the mobiles, like malware attacks. Under the malware attacks, we have virus and rootkits, we have application modifications, OS modification attacks by using the malware and rootkits. Then we have the data exfiltration attack. It will do extracted from data streams and email, print screens and screen scrapping, copy to USB key and loss of backup. Then data tampering also can be done, this kind of attack like modification by another application, undetected tamper attempts, jailbroken device. Now mobile devices, when we do the jailbroke, then it becomes more vulnerable. Then we have data loss also, like data loss, this means loss of device, you will lose the data. unapproved physical access, like your device is accessed by someone which is not, you have not approved. Then application vulnerabilities, the applications which we are using on our device, our mobile device, is not secure, it is vulnerable. All of these can lead to data loss. Now, mobile platform vulnerabilities and risks. These are the vulnerabilities and risks we have. Malicious apps in the stores. So whatever the application we download from the store, it should not be vulnerable and malicious. So if it is malicious, that is a problem, and it can be a mobile malware. Just like we have a malicious application for the desktop, we can have a malicious application for the mobile also, and it will be like malware. App sandboxing vulnerabilities, we have weak devices and app encryption, OS and app update issues. OS and app update issues, we have weak device and app encryption, jailbreaking and rooting the mobile application vulnerabilities are there, privacy issues like geolocations, weak data security, excessive permissions, weak communication security, physical attacks. These are the vulnerabilities and risks we have for our mobile devices. Now, security issues arising from the app store. What is the security issue we have from the application store? First, insufficient or no vetting of apps leads to malicious and fake apps entering app marketplace. So if the insufficient or no vetting of apps is there, then it will be possible that the fake and malicious apps will come into the marketplace. Now, app stores are common target for attackers to distribute the malware and malicious apps. So on the app store, when you see the application is there, so we can actually, any user can also upload the application there. So attackers do what? They try to upload the malicious or malware applications, malicious applications on the app store, so that user feels that this is the genuine app and they can download the app from there. And when they download, they will get the attack. Their devices will be infected. Then attacker can also social engineer user to download and run apps using the apps from the outside of the official app store. Now, what the official app store do basically, they don't allow these malicious and these malware kind of application in their store. Like we have Google app, and for the iOS devices we have the iOS store. So those stores, those applications, those apps, those app stores, they don't allow these malicious apps. What they do actually, they are having their own search scanning engine or virus, or these we can say it is the scanning engine they have. They have their own. So whenever someone uploaded the apps, they scan those applications for these things, for these vulnerabilities or these malicious things. So if they find some apps are not good, or it is a malicious app, or it is having a malicious coding, then what these stores do, these genuine or official stores, they remove those apps. So those apps will not remain there. Now what the attacker do then, attacker try to use the third party app stores. Now you may find lots of different sources, different third party stores, rather than the official store. Like, you can download the application from the Play Store for the Android application, Android mobiles, and you can download the applications from iOS devices. For the iOS devices, you can download it from the iOS store. Now you can also get the applications from the unauthorized third party sources that are third party application stores. So on those third party application stores, they don't do the vetting of applications, or they don't check the applications coding. So attacker can do what? They can upload their application onto this third party app stores, and then they can do the social engineering on the user to click on that link and open the application and download the application from there. So what attacker when try to upload those malicious applications, so these stores, these genuine or these official stores, they have their own vetting technique. They are having their own search engine to scan engine. So they scan those application for the vulnerability things and do what? They remove those application which is vulnerable. So the user will not be able to get these things from the official app store. What the attacker can do, what they can upload it on those third party stores, and then they can send the link for that application to the user through the social engineering and do the different ways. Now the user is the victim is tricked, and he sees that, he feels that this application is good for himself, for this user or for the victim. So it will download the application. It says that this application is not available in the genuine Play Store, the official Play Store. So it will say that the application is available on this third party Play Store, App Store, and it will download it from there and install. Now these malicious apps can damage the other applications and data and send your sensitive data to the attacker also. So if the attacker is if the victim is downloading those malicious apps and installing it in their system, in their device, then it is what? It will be the problem. It can damage the applications. It can damage other applications also. In fact, the other application also. And it can be a Trojan which can send the sensitive information, sensitive data to the attacker also. Then we have app sandboxing issues. Now sandboxing helps to protect system and user by limiting the resources the app can access in the mobile platform. Now however, malicious application may exploit vulnerabilities and bypass the sandboxing. So this sandboxing technique is in the mobile devices. It will secure the environment. In the secure environment, what happened, whatever the application we download, it runs on the sandbox environment. Now sandbox environment, that means they are having their own resources and binaries and libraries for the application to run. But those applications which we install on the device, they will not get the access on our core resources. So our system, our mobile devices, core resources, that resources will not be accessed by the applications we install. Now we give the rights to those applications. We give the rights and permission to those applications when we install to access this and that and that. Now still they are not able to access the system resources. So system resources and other data will be separated from the environment where the application runs. Now this is what the sandboxing. Sandboxing means these applications, whatever the third party or whatever the application we install in our mobile devices, they run under the sandbox. They cannot go out of that sandbox. They cannot access any resources outside from that sandbox. So they can only access the resources which is available under the sandbox, and they don't need to access those system resources. This is the secure environment. And vulnerable environment, where what the application can access and bypass the sandbox environment and can access the other resources and other system core resources. Now normally those applications are not able to access unless we give them the permission to access this system resources. So if we are giving the system resources access to the application, then it becomes a vulnerability and it gets outside of the sandbox. Then we have mobile spam. Now mobile spam means unsolicited text or email messages sent to the mobile device from known or unknown phone numbers or email IDs. So spam messages contain what? Advertisement or malicious links that can trick user to reveal confidential information. Now it is a social engineering part to send the spam or spam things. It can be a spam mail or it can be a spam messages. And it can do what? It can trick the user. Mostly it is advertisement and it is also malicious links for tricking the user to click on that link to reveal the sensitive information. Like means it will click the link and it will take the user to a malicious phishing site where it will capture the information of the user, or for the mobile devices it can also do what, it can trick the user to download the application, and then the user download the application from the third party store and install it in the mobile device, and the mobile device will be compromised. Then a significant amount of bandwidth is wasted by the spam messages also, because these spam messages comes and very in a large number, it can affect the bandwidth of the environment also. Then spam attacks are done for financial gain. Basically these spam emails or messages comes for the attacker wants to gain the financial thing. It wants to get the money. Like you will get the mail, like it says that this dear customer, Vodafone is happy to inform you that your mobile number is selected as a winner of $200,000. To claim amount, click on the link below. You may have seen these messages on your email address or mobile number. Mostly it is saying that congratulations, you won this and that, you have to get some more information, click on that link. When you click on that link, it will take you to some page and it will look like a genuine page, like it is coming from Vodafone. Then what they will ask for your more informations. When you give more information, then you will be in now you will play in their game. Now what? Then they will ask you for the bank detail. They will say your money will be transferred there. Then you will say that lots of things are there. It happens lots of things. Nowadays they do what, they say that you are going to transfer this money, and for this you have to pay this, first you have to pay the processing fees. So out of 200,000 you have to pay 1,000 for the processing fees. Then you will pay the $1,000 and they will never call back. Goodbye Tata. These are like the process of these social engineering attack. So these spam things are basically for gaining the financial gains. SMS phishing attack, just like the email spam and phishing, it can done by the SMS. It can done by the sending the SMS. It is also called smashing attack. It is targeted attack scan because the SMS is targeted to that particular user. So this SMS phishing is the act of trying to acquire personal and financial information by sending SMS, that is instant message or IM, containing deceptive links. So just like the mobile emails, on directly mobile the attacker can send the SMS. Attacker send the SMS, like for example it says attacker buy the prepaid SMS card, and then it sends the message to this user. It says that you won this lottery of 1 million, go to this link to claim your prize again. Then user click the link and redirect to the phishing site. User provides the personal and financial information, and that information will be provided, that information will be redirected to the attacker, and the user will redirected to some other site. Why SMS phishing is effective? It is very effective. And why? Because most of the consumer access internet through the mobile. Nowadays mobiles are very common, and also internet is very common in mobile devices. In old days there was mobile devices without internet, but nowadays the mobile devices we have, and without internet there is no mobile devices nowadays. So most of the user do what, access the internet through mobile devices. Then mobile users are not conditioned to receiving spam text messages on their mobile, and there is no condition to receiving spam text messages on their mobile. Then easy to set up a mobile phishing campaign, and it is very easy to set up. We can just buy a pack of SMS in a prepaid card. We get the prepaid card, buy the pack of SMSs, and then like 100 SMS, 200 SMS, and then we can send the bulk of SMSs to everyone. So if suppose I send the message to 1,000 users, so one of them or two of them can also reply. No mainstream mechanism for weeding out these spam SMSs. There is no mechanism there which we can save. They can save from these spam SMSs. there is no mainstream mechanism available. Difficult to detect and stop before they cause harm. It is also difficult to detect also. Mostly it looks like the genuine thing. So it is very difficult unless it provided it caused the harm. So when it caused the harm, you lost your money, then you will feel like, okay, this was a phishing thing or spam thing. Then most of the mobile antiviruses does not check the SMSs. Even if you use the mobile antiviruses, they don't check the SMS. And even if checks the SMS, it will not detect that, because it looks like it is a genuine message. It is just a message, but the content of the message is not that. The content of the message is malicious. It is tricking the user. It is just tricking the user, and the link, it can be a genuine link of any site that is the attacker is created. Now it looks like the fake site. Now the antiviruses can detect the phishing link when the link is created by the name of a famous site. Like if I try to create the link of Facebook, phishing link of the Facebook site, then antivirus can detect it, because the Facebook site is very known, very much known, and everyone knows that what is the real URL for the Facebook site. So antivirus can detect that the URL, it is saying that it is Facebook, it is not genuine, it is a fake URL. But if the attacker creates the unknown URL, unknown site URL, and its own URL, so antivirus is not able to detect those things. These are the some examples of the SMS phishing. Like attacker can send these kind of messages. It is depend on the creativity of the attacker. Like it says, "Dear Walmart shopper, congratulations, you have won these number of dollars for the Walmart gift card. Click here to claim." It can send, "Your entry last month has won, and go to this and that and claim these and these and these." Now these examples of phishing SMS depends on the user interest also. Because of that, the attackers do the social engineering on the user. So they do the social engineering on the users so that they can find the interest of those users. What are the interest of that user? What are they doing like right now? Suppose the user has downloaded, have purchased something from the Amazon. So it can send this message to the user. Now the attacker knows that recently the user has purchased something from the Amazon. So it can send the message like, "Dear, you have been selected for this 2000 Amazon gift card. Enter the code free." Now the user knows that right now I have purchased something from the Amazon, and maybe there is a chances that I have won something from there. So the user feels like this is maybe genuine. Let's click it and go to the site, and then he's robbed. So for these things is related. These things are related to social engineering, because the social engineering gives the information about the user and the user activity. And based on that user information, the attacker can design the phishing mail or phishing SMS. Then the other attack vector is pairing mobile devices on open Bluetooth and Wi-Fi connection. Now, mobile devices pairing on open connection, that is public Wi-Fi, unencrypted Wi-Fi routers, allows the attackers to eavesdrop and intercept data transmission using techniques such as blue snuffing, that means stealing the information via Bluetooth, blue bugging, that means gaining control over the device via Bluetooth, then sharing the data from malicious devices can infect or breach data on the recipient device also. So if you are connecting to the open wireless network, it can be created by the attacker also. It can be created by the attacker as a raw access point. And if your mobile Bluetooth devices are a Bluetooth is open in your mobile and it is ready to pair someone, and you're pairing openly, it can all lead to these mobile pairing or these kind of attack. That attacker can do the blue snuffing, can steal your information, can do the blue bugging, can gain the control over your device. So So if the open Bluetooth connection is there, so it is the open connection, so attacker comes in Bluetooth range and intercept data transmission. So it will just come in between the range and it can intercept the data, whatever the data it is going from one user to other user. And that user may be connected through the laptop, through the access point. So it can, attacker can create the, attackers can create the raw access point to trick the user to connect to that raw access point. And when they connect, they can whatever they send, it will be sniffed by the attacker. Now, when we talk about the mobile devices, so nowadays we have the mobile devices which is Android OS, which has the Android OS. So most of the mobile devices right now in the world, we use the mobile devices which is Android OS. It has an Android OS. So for hacking the Android OS, first, what is Android OS? Android is a software environment developed by Google for mobile devices that includes an operating system, middleware and key applications. Now features are application framework enabling reuse and replacement of component, Dalvik virtual machine that is optimized for mobile devices, then integrated browser based on the open source WebKit engine, then SQLite for structured data storage, then media support for common audio, video and still image format, that is MPG4 and these other formats, rich development environment including a device emulator, tools for bug debugging, memory and performance profiling, and a plugin for the Eclipse IDE. So this is what the Android OS. Now this is the architecture of the Android operating system. First, it is based on the Linux, Unix-based. It is also a Unix-based operating system. It is based on the Linux kernel. So first, the kernel for this is the Linux kernel. So if you see, the kernel is here and the kernel is a Linux kernel. So Android is basically using the Linux kernel. Now, under the kernel, kernel's job is to interact with the hardware and make the hardware work. And for that, the kernel uses these drivers to work with the drivers or for work with the devices, like display driver for to work with the display device, camera device, it uses camera driver, Wi-Fi driver, keyboard, keypad driver, flash memory driver, audio driver, and binder driver, power management, audio driver. So these are all under the Linux kernel. Then we have the libraries. Libraries and Android runtime. Runtime, that is core libraries, Dalvik virtual machine. So in libraries we have different surface manager, media framework, SQLite, WebKit, libc, SSL, SSG, OpenSSS, FreeType. These are all libraries, and then the core libraries for running the Android runtime. And then we have there is Dalvik virtual machine also there to run these libraries. Then over that we have application framework, where we have different application managers like the package manager, activity manager, telephone manager, windows manager, resource manager, content provider, location manager, notification manager, view the system. And over that application framework we have the applications. Those applications are like phone to do the phone, browsers, contact, home, all these applications we use. So this is the architecture of Android OS. Then Android device administration API. The device administration API introduced in Android 2.2, and it provides the device administration feature at the system level. Now these APIs allow developers to create security aware applications that are useful in enterprise setting, in which IT professional requires rich control over employees' device. Now these policies supported by the device administration API. These are the policies supported by the administration's API. That is password enabled, minimum password length, alphanumerical password required, complex password required, minimum letters required, any in password, max minimum lowercase letter required, minimum non-letter characters required, minimum numeric digital required in password, minimum symbols required in password, minimum uppercase letters required, password expiration timeout, password history, maximum failed password attempt, maximum interactivity, time lockout, require storage encryption, disable camera, promote user to set a new password, lock device immediately, wipe the device data. Now this was introduced in Android 2.2 first time. It is called app device admin tool, which is to do all these things. Now we have Android routing. Now when we use Android devices, now remember it is actually based on Linux kernel. Now Linux kernel, in Linux operating system, the user which has all the access on the system, all the access on the operating system and all the resources, that user is called root. It is called root user. Now what is the meaning of rooting? Now rooting allows the Android user to attain privilege control known as root access. Now within Android subsystem, rooting process involves exploiting security vulnerabilities in the device framework and copying the SU binary to a location in the current process path, that is under system X bin SU, and granting it executable permission with the chmod command. We have Android device. Now what that means, we have Android device, and Android device is based on the Linux system. So Linux system has a root user. It is an administrator of the system. Now by default, when you are we use the Android device, on that there is no root user actually. The root user is not there. That means the root user's binary is not installed. Binaries, that means the command and execution path, they are not there. The command executions and execution files for the root is not there. So it is by default runs on the non-privileged user, that is not root. So root user is not there, but the rooting means what? It is basically means creating the root user by installing the root user binaries. And we can say it is to create the root user's command, install the root user's command and create the root user. Now when you have a root user on your Android mobile, that means you are having the administrator now. First there was no administrator, now we have the administrator who has all the control, and it can also access the system resources, the core resources out of the sandbox. Remember the sandbox where the application runs, and they cannot go and they cannot access other resources out of sandbox, because by default there is no root access. Now when you do the rooting of Android device, that means you create the root access. Now root access can do what? It can access resources out of the sandbox. So if the application asks for the permission for the root, and if the root user is there, if the Android is rooted, then it can get the access of out of the sandbox. So rooting enable all the users, all the user installed application to run privileged commands such as modifying or deleting system files. Remember, it can even access the files, it can delete the system files, modules, ROMs, stock ROMs, stock firmware and kernels, and removing carrier or manufacturer installed application, that is baltware. Now remove this carrier or manufacturer installed application, that means it is called blotware. Now these are the applications which comes with the it comes pre-built. Like when you purchase a mobile, Android mobile from me, Xiaomi, so they give you some of the application pre-installed. They give some pre-installed applications for their own company. So those are kind of application called blotware. So they will not remove. If you try to remove those applications, normally they don't remove. They only remove with the root access. So if you have a root access, then you can remove those applications also. Low level access to the hardware that are typically unavailable to the device in their default configurations. improve the performance, Wi-Fi and Bluetooth tethering, installed application on SD card, better user interface and keyboard. So we can do lots of things when we do the routing of our Android device and provide the root access. Now routing also comes with many security and other risks to your device, including void your phone's warranty. First, your warranty will be over. So if you root your device, your warranty will be expire. Then it can decrease the performance, poor performance also. And then also it can lead to the malware infection. So malware infection can also be done because the application, when the malware application runs comes in your system, then it can get the access of the system resources and system files, and it can lead to the breaking the device. Now breaking the device, that means completely device will be unusable. It can completely unusable because it can get the access of system resources, system files, even kernel, and it can delete the resources, system files and kernel if the malware is infected. And remember, when the malware comes, it asks for the root access. And when you give the root access, first it will ask, and when you give the root access, now how you will give the root access, because you have already rooted your device. Now if you have not rooted the device, you will not be able to give the root access to the application. But once you have rooted the device, you can give the root access. Now when the application or malware, these malicious application, get the root access, it can do infect your hardware, it can infect the kernel, it can get the access of these ROM files, and it can get the access of the system files. And now what they can do, they can delete, they can modify to get steal your information, they can delete to do the denial of service attack, and your system, your mobile will be bricked. And bricked means unusable. The device will become unusable, unrecoverable. Now for rooting the Android phones, we have different ways. We have the different applications also for rooting the Android phones. We have Super One Click. This is a tool. This is a plugin and connect your Android device to your computer via USB. Then install the driver for the device if promoted, so that your device will be detected in your phone, in your computer. Then unplug and reconnect, but this time select charge only. So how you can do the routing by using this software? So connect and disconnect, and this time choose the charge only to ensure that your phone's SD card is not mounted to your PC. When you select the USB mass storage, so your SD card will be detected. So this time you will select charge only, your SD card will not be mounted. Then you go to setting application deployment and enable USB debugging to put your Android into USB debugging mode. Debugging mode, it is available under the settings of any Android device. So there is an option to enable the USB debugging. Now when you enable this, it will start debugging from the USB device. Now run the Super One Click EXE. It is available. You can get it from the online source. So you will click Super One Click, and it will install. It will start. Then click on the root button there in that application. Now wait for some time until you see the running SU test success message comes. Now when the message comes, SU test success. Now check out the installed apps in your phone, and superior icon, super user icon, means you now have root access. Reboot the phone if you do not see it. So if you don't see that, then you reboot the device, you will see that. And by using this Super One Click and by using the process, you can root your mobile, you can do the Android rooting. Then we have the other tools also, like Super Boot. So first you download and extract the Super Boot files, then put your Android phone in bootloader mode. Turn off the phone. Now how you will put your Android device in bootloader mode? First, turn off the phone, remove the battery and plug in the USB cable. Then when the battery icon appears on screen, pop the battery back in. Now tap the power button while holding down the camera key. So holding down the camera key or volume key. Then put the power button for some time. Hold the power button for some time. Now for Android phones with the trackball, turn off the phone and press and hold the trackball, then turn the phone back on. Now if suppose you are not having a volume key there or camera key there, then you can, there are some phones which has a trackball into it. So if the trackball is there, so you click on that trackball and the power on button for some time. So it will go the, it will take your mobile to the bootloader mode. Now in nowadays the mobile devices has that volume key, so we can use the volume key for that. So power key and volume key, we have to shut down the mobile device and then restart the device by pressing that key. Hold down the key, both the key at the same time, power up and volume up and power key. Then third, depending on your computer's operating system, do one of the following. Like first, if you are having Windows, then double click and install the superbootwindows.bat, this software. And if you are using Mac, then open a terminal window to the directory containing the file and type this command chmod to provide the permission of execution, and execute that sh file followed by the install file. And in Linux also we have to do the same thing, because Mac and Linux also are same. Then after the this script is run, your device has been rooted. So this install superboot .bat is an script of Windows, and these mac.sh is for Mac and linux.sh is for the Linux. These are script file. Then we have the other tools and other Android rooting tools like these: unrevoked, rescue root, unlock root pro. Then hacking networks using network spoofer. Now we have in Android devices these network spoofer also. So first, network spoofer lets you change website on other people's computers from an Android phone. Now it will do what? It will allow you to change the website on other people's computers from an Android phone. Features of this software is flip pictures upside down, flip text upside down, make website experience gravity, then redirect website to other pages, delete random words from website, replace words on websites with others, and change all pictures to troll face, or wobble all pictures graphics around a bit. So it looks like this as you see in the picture. First you have to set up and install, and then you can start. You have multiple spoofs. We can run multiple spoofs. You can add logs. You can do all sites. You can go, you can redirect all site to this particular kittenware.com. You can redirect all site to some other site. We can blur the image, custom Google search change, custom image change, like image on phone, or custom image change, image on website. So we can change these things by using these network spoofer. Then these kind of software requires the root access. Remember, these are what the hacking things, these are hacking tools, and these requires the root access. Now you can't believe all these tools, because they can harm your device itself also, because they want to get the root access. Then session hijacking. We can use session hijacking by using this Droid Sheep. Now session hijacking, it can do the sidejacking. It do what? Droid Sheep is a simple Android tool for web session hijacking. It listen for HTTP packets sent via wireless network connection and extract the session IDs from these packets in order to reuse them. droidship can capture sessions using the libpcap and library, and export and support open network WEP encrypted networks, WPA and WPA2, PSK only, not enterprise encrypted network. So it do what? It can listen and it can sniff the data network, and it can do what? It can try to extract the session ID and cookie from that session. So this user is connected through the access point to the internet. So attacker do what? It will first do the ARP spoofing. Attacker modifies the session IDs and relay them to the web server. That means first it will do the ARP spoofing so that the packet, the data will come to the attacker machine. Now attacker intercept the client request for the web page, and the request, from that request it will get what? The session ID and all, and then with using that session ID it relay them to the web server to connect behalf of this user. It is the session hijacking attack by using the session ID or cookie. And it can do, we can do that by using this droidship tool on our mobile. That we don't need to have the internet, we don't have to have a computer, we can do it from this Android device. We have this option, ARP spoofing and then generic mode. Then we have also one more tool, Face Sniff. This Face Sniff is an Android app that allows you to sniff and intercept web session profiles over the Wi-Fi that your mobile is connected to. And it is possible to hijack sessions only when the Wi-Fi is not using EAP. EAP is the WPA or WPA2 enterprise version, where the authentication done on the centralized server. But it should work over any private networks, that is open, WEP, WPA, WPA with PSK or WPA2 with PSK, that is pre-shared key. Then we have Android based sniffers like packet sniffer, T-capture, then we have T-packet capture, and we have Android PCAP. These are the sniffer tool, just like we have desktop, in desktop we have Wireshark. Then in these mobile devices also we have these packet sniffers to sniff the packets. For sniffing the packet, first we have to be in the middle and then we can sniff the packet. And here in this, even it can sniff the Bluetooth traffic also. So if the Bluetooth traffic is going on, then it will also, it can do what? It can sniff the traffic and can see the data is going on. Then we have the Trojans for the Android devices also. Now Trojan is like Zigmo. It is the Zeus in the mobile option. In the desktop computers we have Zeus for the mobile banking Trojan. Now in the mobile, for the banking Trojan in the mobile, this is Zigmo, is the small version for the Zeus in the mobile. Now this Zigmo is the notorious mobile component of the Zeus banking Trojan that circumvent two-factor authentication by intercepting SMS confirmation code to access bank account. And the new version for Android and BlackBerry have now added botnet like features also, such as enabling cyber criminals to control the Trojan via SMS command. So this is a Trojan which can infect your machine, which can infect your mobile device. And it will do what? This Trojan is basically designed to access the mobile banking communication or banking transactions, and it only attacks on that banking transaction. And nowadays they create these Trojan, they included with the botnet features also, that the attacker can control the Trojan by sending just an SMS message. Then the Android Trojans, the other Android Trojans, we have Fake Token and Trumpa, that is Trump A. This fake token steals both banking authentication factors, that is internet password or M10, directly from the mobile device. So whenever you do any transaction nowadays, for the second authentication you got the SMS on your mobile device. You get the SMS, on that SMS you get the 10 number, or you can say the verification code. So these Trojan can do what? They can steal those things and steal those things and send back to the attacker. So attacker will do the transition on behalf of you, and whatever the this verification code comes to your mobile, it will steal that code and it will send it to the attacker. Then attacker complete the transition and you don't know what happens. Then just like that, Trump A is that it is designed to lock the keystrokes of target Android mobile to steal passwords and other sensitive information. This is a keylogger. This is a keylogger for the mobile devices. Then the other trojans we have Fake Defender and OBard. This Fake Defender is a Trojan horse for Android devices that display fake security alerts in an attempt to convince the user to purchase an app in order to remove non-existent malware or security risks for the device. So when this Fake Defender infect your Android machine, so your machine, your mobile starts sending you, start showing you the notification alerts like this is wrong, this is something happened, you have to download this software to free up your mobile, clear your mobile or scan your mobile because this virus and that virus is infecting your mobile or something like this, and it will fool you to purchase some applications. So you will say like, okay, this is something happened to my mobile and to clean this thing I have to purchase this application, and you will purchase those application and try to scan your device. OBard trojan is distributed through different methods such as mobile botnet, traditional SMS spam, then Google Play fake store. Now it gains administrator privilege and use an exploit to break through the Android operating system's security layer. Then we have Fake Inst and OpFake. These Fake Inst trojan send SMS messages to premium rate phone numbers or a subscription based paid services. Now this one do what? It will send automatically messages to those premium rate phone numbers. Those phone numbers who get paid by getting the messages. So it will send those messages and you will be paid for those messages, the heavy amount. Then OpFake Android, this Android OpFake is a detection for Trojan horse on the Android platform that send SMS text to premium rate numbers. Again, this is also for sending the messages to premium numbers. Now those premium numbers will get the money when they get messages and calls. So you are going to pay those money because your device is sending those messages. You don't know what is happening. Your device will work in a background. These trojans will do what? They will send those messages. Then we have AndroRat and Dendroid. Now this AndroRat, it allows a remote attacker to gain control over the device and steal information from it. It allows a remote attacker to perform various actions such as retrieve call logs and contact information, place a call, etc. Then Dendroid. This Dendroid is an HTTP rat that is marketed as being transported transparent to the user and firmware interface, having a sophisticated PHP panel and an application APK binder package, and it generates a malicious APK files that can delete call logs, open web pages, etc. Now how we can secure our Android device? How we can secure our Android devices? Now first, enable screen locks for your Android phones for it to be more secure. So first you have to be a lock there. That means your device must be locked with your screen lock, password, whatever. Then do not directly download Android packages files. Then don't directly download the package files. Now package file for the Android devices are called .apk. So .apk files are the Android package files. So don't download it directly. Always download it from the genuine or authorized Play stores or authorized app stores. Then never root your Android device. So whatever I said, the rooting means what? It will give the root access in your mobile, in your Android device, And getting the root access means the applications can do what? Can come out of the sandbox environment and they can access the system resources. And they can do what? They can corrupt your system resources, system files, kernels, and break your device for permanently. Then update the operating system regularly. So whenever you get the update, always update your operating system. Then download apps only from the official Android market. Use free protector Android app like Android Protector, where you can assign password to text messages, mail accounts, etc. Keep your device updated with Google Android antivirus software. Then customize your locked home screen with the user's information also. That means customize your locked home screen with the user's information. That means when your device is locked, so it should not show the information like when you message, when the message comes or email comes or anything. So when your device is locked, then those message content must not be visible. In your setting, there is an option there to select to hide these things. So if any mail or message come, SMS come, so it will not show on the lock screen. So when your device is locked, and if suppose the message comes, so it will not show the content. It will only show that the message is there, but it will not show the content. But you have to configure the setting under the settings. If you don't configure it, then it will reveal the message content also. And if suppose the screen is locked and your content is visible, then the attacker don't have to unlock your phone. It can directly see the code. Then Google Apps device policies. This Google Apps device policies app allows Google Apps domain admin to set security policies for your Android devices. Then it is a device administration app for Google Apps for businesses, educations, and government accounts that makes your Android devices more secure for enterprise use. So we can use the devices on the enterprise by using this Google Apps device policy. And this app allows ID administrators to enforce security policies and remotely wipe your device also. It can remove all the data from your device also. Then additionally, this app allows you to ring, lock, or locate your Android devices through the My Device app that is available under the Google app My Device. So we can do these all things. We can wipe out the data, you can lock the screen, you can ring the Android device also. Okay, this is the one which is My Device of Google Android phones. So you have to logged in with the account in the browser. You have to logged in with the account which you have used to log in your mobile device. So you will see this. You will see your mobile number name here. You will see that is it online or off, offline. You can see the location is on or off. Right now the location is off, so you can't track the phone where it is. If the location is on, then you can see the device location also. Now I enable the location setting of my mobile so I can see where my mobile is located. So when I refresh, it shows that my device is around this area. And I can see it is around this area. So we can see where our mobile device is, what is the wireless network it is connected, what is the status of battery. We can play the sound for the device, on the device. So it is playing the sound on the device. Again. Now we have, this is just to play the sound, but we can secure the device. We can lock the device and sign out of your Google account. Then you can also display a message or phone number on the lock screen. You can still locate the device after it's locked. So you can lock it from here. You can erase all the data from your mobile so that nobody can have your data. You can just erase your data. Now for doing all these things, your device must be connected to internet. And if it is not connected to internet, then it is not possible to do this. Then we have the remote wipe out service also, wipe service also, it is called remote wipe. So if user have Google Sync installed on a supported mobile device or an Android device with a Google app device policy app installed, so they can use the Google admin console to remotely wipe the device. So if this application Google app device policy app is installed there, so it can use the console for the admin console from the machine, from the laptop, and it can wipe out all the data from the mobile. So if your mobile is stolen and you want to remove the data from it, like your company or your organization important data is there, or your personal important data is there, you don't want someone to get the data, then you can just destroy the data from here. So to remote wipe out a lost or stolen device, what you do, sign into your Google admin console and click device management, manage device. In the device tab, hover your cursor over the user whose device you want to wipe. So this is the admin console where you can manage the many devices it has, and it can select the device which it wants to wipe out. Then click the wipe out button, wipe remote wipe or wipe account in the box that appears here, and then the second box appears asking you to confirm that you want to remotely wipe the device. If you are sure you want to wipe the device, then click wipe and it will remove all the information, all the data from that device. Then we have the Android security tool, that is Droid Ship Guard. This Droid Ship Guard monitor your phone ARP table and pop up alerts in case it detects suspicious entries in the phone ARP table. So if someone is trying to do the ARP attack on your device in your mobile, so this software, this Droid Ship Guard, now Droid Ship is a software to do the ARP attack, and this software is a Droid Ship Guard. It is to save the machine from that Droid Ship attack, Droid Ship ARP attack. So it can immediately disable Wi-Fi connection to protect your account, and Droid Ship Guard works with all ARP based attacks like Droid Ship and Facelift. So whether you're attacking, whether the attacker is using Droid Ship or Facelift, it can detect all those attacks. Then we have Android security tools is TrustGo Mobile Security and Sophos Mobile Security. This TrustGo Mobile Security safe lets you know which apps are free from malware and risk before you download. So before you download, it will alert you that this application is malware or not. Then Sophos Mobile Security protects your Android device without reducing performance and helps you avoid undesirable softwares. So it will scan and show you that these devices, these applications are having some malicious things or not, and it can allow you to remove those. Then we have Android security tools. Under that we have 360 security, AVL and Avira antivirus security. So these are the different tools also we have to do the complete security. Like these are antiviruses, we can say, for our Android devices. Then we have vulnerability scanner for the Android. It is called X-ray. This X-ray scans your device, Android device, to determine whether they are vulnerabilities that remains unpatched by your carrier. So whether there is any vulnerability is there and which is not patched by our carrier. So it scans and show you those vulnerabilities. It presents you with a list of vulnerabilities that it is able to identify and allows you to check for the presence of each vulnerability on your device. This X-ray is automatically updated with the ability to scan for new vulnerabilities as they are discovered and disclosed. So just like the new vulnerabilities comes for the Android devices in the world, so it will be updated for this X-ray. The X-ray will get the update and it will be updated for new vulnerabilities. and then it can help you to detect those vulnerabilities in your device. Then we have Android tracking to device tracking tools. These are the different device tracking softwares like Find My Phone, Pre-Anti-Theft, My Anti-Theft, Where Is My Droid, and all these other tools which can help you to find your device. So where your device is, where it is, what is the location, and also it allows you to do other things. We have saw the default option which we have available in the Google, where you can go to the Google My Device and you can see where is your device. But to see those things, your device must be enabled with the location. So if it is not enabled, then you will not be able to see your device location.